Welcome to Money Making Conversation. I am your host, Rashawn McDonald. Like I say every week on my show, it's time to stop reading other people's success stories and start writing your own. We always talk about gifts and passion. If you have a gift, lead with your gift. And don't let your age, friends, family, or coworkers stop you from planning or living your dreams. My interviews on Money Making Conversation include celebrities, CEOs, entrepreneurs, and people I like to call industry decision makers. My next guest is Judge Rhonda Wills. Since forming a law firm nearly two decades ago, Judge Wills has recovered over $100 million fighting for the rights of everyday Americans and their plight against corporate giants. She uses her expertise and intellect to give voice to those who need her most, the worker who has been wronged by their employer, a person who has been discriminated against, sexually harassed and sexually assaulted, and those who have suffered catastrophic physical injuries. She is now making a mark on TV. Come on now. Star of a new court show, Relative Justice with Judge Rhonda Wills. It is a new arbitration-based reality court show which centers on solving interfamily legal disputes. We got to find out what that's all about. Relative Justice with Judge Rhonda Wills premieres in September and has been cleared in 80% of the country. That's a lot for a new show. I'm going to tell you, that's pretty impressive. And once everybody discovers she's a hit, she's going to be 100%, okay? Please check out your local listening because you should watch this show. Judge Rhonda Wills is on the show to talk about her career and building her dream. Please welcome to Money Making Conversations for the very first time, but not the last time, Judge Rhonda Wills. How you doing?
Hi there, Rashawn. How are you? It's great to be with you.
Thank you. I hope I got enough information about you out there, you know, because you perked up a little bit when I was talking about you. So I'm assuming a lot of people don't tell your story when they're doing these interviews.
Well, you know, a lot of people do, but there are always a lot of other things I want people to know about me, but right. I think you cover most of it.
Well, good. Because, you know, when we look at, let's be honest, when you look at a person, you're attractive, and some people tend to just feel that way, and they forget the fact that there's a journey for anybody, no matter how they look. So tell us how, I know you're a Texas girl, because I'm a Texas boy, okay? And I know you live in Houston. I'm from Houston, so we're already hitting it off of you. You're over there by the Tyler Rose country in East Texas. That's where you was born and raised.
Yes.
No, over there, Earl Campbell country. She's an Earl Campbell country, but she's raising us.
That's right.
And her family, and delivering a level of success in Houston, Texas. Let's talk about how you got started in the law business and what attracted you to that, because in my show, Money Making Conversations, I try to give people that you can do it too. And a lot of people stop and feel they have to be born in a certain family or live in a certain part of the country. But you come from a small, very small smithy. You're born and raised. But that didn't stop you from going to a big school like the University of Texas. Talk about your journey in the early years, Judge Wills.
So, first of all, Rashawn, thank you so much for having me on your podcast. This is amazing. I've been watching your podcast. You're doing great things. And so I'm excited to be here. Mm-hmm. My story is one of very humble beginnings. I'm from this little bitty town called Winona. It's in East Texas, right outside of Tyler. Mm-hmm. I'm one of five children. I was raised by a single mother and my grandmother and was just raised in a really, really, frankly, poor family. Mm-hmm. And I always knew that there was a lot of injustice in the world. And I always wanted to be someone who could right those wrongs and mm-hmm. help people. Mm-hmm. And I was just very fortunate that I went to the University of Texas undergrad on a full scholarship. I got an international business degree. And then I went on to the University of Texas and got a law degree, again, on a full scholarship, mm-hmm. And started my law practice. And I started out working for a really, really, really big law firm.
Right.
And I that wasn't what I wanted to do. My passion was with helping people. And that's what I wanted to do, was to help people. So I started my own law firm. Mm-hmm. And I have focused my law practice for the last two decades on helping people, just everyday Americans, to fight corporate giants. Because in many of the cases that I take, if I didn't speak for them, if I was not their voice, they wouldn't have a voice. And when really bad things happen to right. people, right. be it being sexually assaulted or sexually harassed in the workplace, mm-hmm. being discriminated against on the basis of your race, your gender, your sexual orientation, any of those things, surviving a catastrophic personal injury, without someone to come in and help you to get economic justice, a lot of people would have no justice and would have no way to start and try and rebuild their life after going through something extremely tragic. So I always knew that I wanted to be a person who would go out there and fight for the voiceless and fight for people that really, really, really wouldn't have a voice unless I stood up and fought for them.
Now, Judge Rhonda Wills here. I'm asking a simple question. It may not be, but to me, what makes a good lawyer?
I think that what makes a good lawyer is someone, first of all, who studies the law, who knows the law, and somebody who's willing to go out and fight and be fearless in the face of whoever they're up against. I'm fortunate in that I'm licensed in Texas, California, and New York,
right?
Which just means I took a lot of bar exams, did a lot of studying, but I practice all over this country. I represent people all over the country. One thing that I found is oftentimes I can walk in to a courtroom and there's nobody there that looks like me,
right?
But that doesn't matter to me. Doesn't matter if I'm the only woman in the courtroom. It doesn't matter if I'm the only Black person in the courtroom.
Right.
Doesn't matter if I'm the only Black woman in the courtroom, because at the end of the day, I'm going to bring it. As my grandmother always told me, you will come up against people who have more money than you do, who maybe went to better schools than you went to. But one thing about it is no one will ever outwork me.
Right.
So I've always made that my mantra. You will never outwork me. So no matter what it takes, I put in the work. And that's what I try to encourage, especially young women to do, to know that you can do anything. Don't let anybody tell you what you can or can't do. You can do anything. You just have to put in the work.
And let me ask you this, because, you know, because it's funny watching you, because and it's a good funny, because you got passionate in that spiel. First, you know, you did the nice thing. Rashawn, I'm so happy to be on the show. I heard a lot of great things about it. Cool. Now, that speech right there, you got closer to the camera. You know, your forehead browed a little bit. So because that's what attracted people, I'm sure, when you did spots on television. You know, you use information with passion, and that's what's missing on television right now. But what's more importantly, I'm just telling you, she said no matter what school. Now, I'm going to tell you about University of Texas. That's one of the top schools in the country. Okay, so let's go. She didn't just go to a regular school. It's like a city. They own Austin, Texas. So I would just put that in perspective. She went to a great school. She got a scholarship at an amazing school. Even though I graduated from University of Houston, I still can be respectful for UT and what they delivered down in Austin, Texas. Now, when you as an individual who started trying to make a difference, we see so many commercials on TV. Hire this person. Hire, you know, it's like, law firms have gotten so powerful from a commercial standpoint, they actually will sponsor news shows, the local news. That's why I asked that question, what makes a good lawyer? Because nowadays, everyday people are just hit with so much information on the radio, in print, on TV, and social media. How do they cut through that to make the right decision to work with a lawyer that's going to benefit them? I guess that's the question I should have asked you initially, because of the fact that advertisement for law firms and lawyers is so dominant in the media today.
Well, first and foremost, if they need a good lawyer, call my law firm, Wills Law Firm, PLLC. So call me first.
There you go. There are
a lot of great law firms out there. I think the most important thing that people need to do is to educate themselves and to make sure that you're hiring someone as a lawyer who's going to represent you and be passionate about representing you. I never, ever stop fighting for my clients, no matter what. I have gone up against some of the biggest corporate giants. One of my biggest cases was I got a $20 million settlement against Wells Fargo in a class action case. I represent a lot of people. I've had a lot of class action cases where, for example, a group of African Americans that were being paid less than their white counterparts.
Right.
I have, you know, represented people that weren't paid all their wages. So for a lot of people, they just don't get it. You know, they think, okay, well, you only got paid for 40 hours instead of 50 hours. You worked 50 hours. Well, I was raised by a single mother. Sometimes my mother had to work two and three jobs in order to take care of us. So I know what it means when somebody doesn't get paid when they work 50 hours as opposed to 40 hours. And those 10 hours that they didn't get paid for, that can mean the difference between food on the table or food not being on the table. So because of my humble background, I know what it means for everyday people to struggle, to fight. Mm-hmm. And when I see these big corporations that put profits over people,
right,
that makes me angry and that makes me fight. I've had to fight cases all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court. I'm licensed before the U.S. Supreme Court. Mm-hmm. So I will fight no matter how long, how hard it requires, I will fight. And that case that I had before the U.S. Supreme Court, I won a $5.2 million judgment for my client who had his throat slashed at work by a coworker. Wow. I won a $5.2 million verdict against that company, and they fought me all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court, and I fought them and won.
Wow. Now, you know, you didn't get into this business to be on TV. Everybody, you know, you got into business because of, you know, you smart enough to get scholarships, both undergraduate and graduate. And then you launched, you went to a big firm, and then, because guess what, your academics allowed you to be recruited, and you said yes. And then you said, you know, something, that's not me, which is always a fear that people have. There's so many people out there listening to the show that are going through life stuck in relationships, stuck in jobs that they shouldn't be, because they're fearful of making that first step. How were you conscious from a confidence standpoint, or did you turn to other people when you decided to say, you know, I know this check is nice and it's regular, got health benefits, but it's not me. What pushed you to that next level to say, I'm a ride and die with Rhonda Wills?
Well, there was one case I had in particular. I had a trial, and the person on the, I represented a big corporation. Mm-hmm. And the person on the other side of that case was a Black man. Mm-hmm. And this Black man was denied a contract, a multi-million dollar contract. And I had to go in court and fight against this Black man. Wow. Who had built his own business, had worked hard. And my job was to go in and break this man down and destroy him. Wow. And we tried the case. And ultimately, we beat him. And my mother came and she watched me in that trial. And at the end of that trial, my mother looked at me and she said, baby, you did a great job. And that poor little man over there, you're going to beat him. But she said, are you really on the right side of this? Right. Just because you can do something doesn't mean you should be doing that. Mm. And I think you need to look at yourself in the mirror and ask yourself, is this really what I went to law school for?
Right.
And so when my mother broke that down to me like that, I realized, no, this is not what I went to law school for. I went to law school to represent people like the man that I just broke down and beat in court.
Right.
And that was my wake up call.
We know that. I'm going to take a minute on that because that was pretty powerful, because sometimes in life, money doesn't mean anything. I always tell people, I'm not in the game for the money. I'm in the game for the opportunity. If the opportunity presents itself, that something that I feel will personally benefit me and the people around me, then I move forward on it. And that's the case, I think, was happening there. The money brought you the opportunity, but the opportunity wasn't what you wanted to pursue long term. And so when that's why parents are great, because they can look over that other side and go, child, I don't know why you doing that. Okay. Mm-hmm. You put some plate on that food on that plate, some else, you know, some other ways, you know, I know that's right.
So Rhonda, but you know what, Rashawn, the most amazing thing about it is, so I was working at that big firm, mm-hmm. and the check was good. I'm not going to lie. The check was really good. But when I left and I stepped out on faith, yes. and started doing what I passionately wanted to do, I have made far more money.
Absolutely.
Ever since I left that law firm, I've made 7 figures every year since I left that law firm.
That's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. Now, yes. Now you're on TV. Come on now. You're on TV.
Now I'm on TV.
Woo! What? Okay, now, we know the queen out there, Judge Judy. She been the queen. Judge Judy's on TV sometimes 4 hours a day. Some cities. Now you gonna come in there, and there's a lot of people have come in. I know my boy, you know, Judge Joe Brown, that was my boy. You know, out there doing it. Judge Mathis, my boy. Judge Mayla Bleen, that's my girl. And now, my girl, I'm going to call you my girl too, Judge Rhonda Wills coming out there.
So, yes.
So why did you, because you're successful. You have a great family, you have a great mom. Why are you getting in the TV business like this with this show, which is a wonderful show, by the way?
Thank you. So first of all, before I did Relative Justice, I had another show on WeTV called Sisters in Law. Mm-hmm. And it was a reality-based TV show based in Houston that mm-hmm. followed my legal career. Mm-hmm. And so that kind of got me into thinking about TV as something that I might want to do. Before mm-hmm. that, I never even thought about it. When this opportunity came along, it seemed perfect for me because I'm from a huge family. Mm-hmm. I have four kids of my own. Mm-hmm. I'm one of five kids. Mm-hmm. My grandmother had 10 kids and mm-hmm. I've got more than 50 first cousins.
Right.
So mm-hmm. I'm from a huge family. Mm-hmm. So what makes this show, my show, Relative Justice with Judge Rhonda Wills, what makes it different from the other court TV shows is that we focus only on disputes between family members. So everyone that comes on my show, every litigant that you see, they're related by blood or marriage or children.
Right.
So that's what made this fascinating for me because it's different from every other court TV show.
Right. Well, you know, the thing about that, you know, I family, girl, that can be ugly. Now,
yes. You
know, it get really, I'm just thinking, because yes. you sit up here, that's what make me funny about Rhonda. You know, she's talking about a big family. I come from six sisters, two brothers. So I'm about to kill that little big family theory that you pitching out there. You know, I was number five. You just only had five. Okay, you running around out. So we just going to kill that little big family theory when you're talking to me. And my aunt had 16 kids. So we going to kill wow. that other story. Okay, that's my fun part of just talking to you. But when you get into these, what made you, or how, okay, first of all, is it taped in LA? Where is it taped at? The show. Where's
so
that?
The show is taped in Lexington, Kentucky.
Okay.
Which for me was great because I'm a small town girl and I'm a Southern girl. Mm-hmm. So it was like going home for me to be filming in Lexington.
Oh, it's beautiful because they do have yeah. that white picket fence when you go around and drive those Kentucky horse yeah. ranches. It's beautiful up in Kentucky. So I've been up there. Now, when you're putting the show together, like say you had that stint on reality TV. And I always tell people when I interview people who do reality TV, why? You know, why did you do reality TV? And then you told us an opportunity to come and do your own show, Relative Justice with Judge Rhonda Wills. And you're taping it in Kentucky, but you live in Houston. And then you still have a successful law firm. Why? I have to ask the question, why? And that's a positive why. It's not a negative why when I say that, because some people will tell you, isn't enough enough? Don't you have, you got it going on. You look good. You got money. You got kids. You got when you going to stop, Rhonda? What's your problem, girl?
Well, I will tell you that I feel like a full life is a blessing. And every blessing that mm-hmm. God brings to me, mm-hmm. I embrace it with open arms mm-hmm. and I run with it. Mm-hmm. So when this opportunity was brought to me yes. to do this show, mm-hmm. again, this was a unique concept. There's no other court TV show mm-hmm. out there like this one because we only focus on families. Mm-hmm. Now, when they come into my courtroom, it's a money dispute.
Yes.
And I resolve the money dispute. But above and beyond that money dispute, because these are families that you're dealing with, I try to bring the families back together again.
Right.
There are some cases in my courtroom where sisters get into a dispute about money and they haven't spoken for years.
Wow.
And they come into my courtroom. I have to resolve this money issue and then try to get them back to being sisters again. I had one case where a mother was there against her son and daughter-in-law.
Right.
She had taken out a restraining order against her daughter-in-law.
Right.
So they had to sign waivers just to be in the courtroom because she had a restraining order against her daughter-in-law. That's how broken down this family was. At the end of this episode, at the end of my resolution of this case, the mother, the daughter-in-law, and the son are all crying and hugging. And have committed to building their relationship again and being a family again. So it's things like that that made me feel like I'm really, really making a difference. I got into the practice of law to make a difference.
Right.
And I'm doing this TV show to make a difference. And the other thing, Rashawn, that you're going to see about my show,
yes,
Relative Justice, that's mm-hmm. different from other shows. So oftentimes a lot of these family dramas, mm-hmm. a lot of it... it's not just something that people can work through on their own.
Mm-hmm.
And I refer people for counseling and therapy where appropriate, mm-hmm. either family counseling, individual counseling. Sometimes it's drug counseling. Sometimes it's trauma therapy.
Mm-hmm.
But we also had a therapist on staff
wow.
who was there. And I would refer some of the families to sit down and meet with the therapist because there's so much stigma attached to getting therapy and getting counseling. And oftentimes, especially with families.
Right.
There's a money dispute here, but that's just the surface. And when you scratch underneath the surface, there's something much deeper and much more dramatic going on. And sometimes you need the help of a therapist. a family therapist in particular to help you as a family work through it.
Well, you know, I'm talking to Judge Rhonda. She has a new show that's going to be on 80% of the country. Again, congratulations. That's a high number for a new show. A lot of people understand in syndication, which is a very competitive market. And, you know, you've been presiding over a show through, they say, your show Compassion and Tough Love. You resolve litigants' legal disputes, but to work towards, like you said, bringing families back together in the process. We all know that's the end goal. But I know you're early in your judge career in this TV format. Has anything shocked you yet? You go, I can't believe they just couldn't understand. Like you just talked about, the restraining order and for the daughter-in-law. And it's just so many things that are going on out there. Has anything really went, wow, that's crazy?
So, Rashawn, like every day, yeah. I would say that's crazy to something. But I will tell you, the amazing thing about relative justice, people will want to tune in every day because every day is different. Yes. There are some days where with some cases, I'm laughing so hard that I can barely get my ruling out because I'm laughing. I'm about to fall from behind the bench because I'm laughing so hard.
Right.
And there are other cases where it's just so sad, I'm crying. I'm almost crying. Mm-hmm. Everybody in the audience is crying. The litigants are crying. Mm-hmm. And then there are other cases where people do something that's so wrong, so toxic,
you get angry.
So terrible that I have to tell them. Mm-hmm. I have to tell them you're wrong. And you need to change and you need to do better. And I have to actually go in on them. So every single day is different. We have experts that come in. We have demonstrations. Okay, so one show
in particular.
There you go,
there you go. Come on now.
My show in particular, we have a pole dancer. One of the litigants is a pole dancer. And you don't want to miss the episode with the pole dancer.
Absolutely.
Like, my mouth was dropped the whole time when the pole dancer was on there. You don't want to miss that.
Well, I'm going to just tell you, just watching your energy, you're amazing. I'm going to compliment you on that. And I'm just happy you decided to just be, you know, Rhonda Wills in this interview, because sometimes we can get stiff and just trying to deliver information. And hopefully my story and my interview and the way I was just walking you through the process gave you a comfort zone. You are funny. You are smart. I'm going to watch the show, and I want to bring you back on in the spring when we talk about you in 100% of the country. But again, I just want to say congratulations on this show. And I'm going to tell your team, you know, I got almost 1 million followers on social media. So tell your team to send me some banners so I can posted on my social media. You're a Texas girl. I'm a Texas boy. I got to support you no matter what, girl. Okay?
Thank you. Thank you so much.
And good luck with your show.
It.
All right, Judge Rhonda
much
Wills.
Love.
Okay?
Thank you.
I appreciate you. Good luck.
Great being with you. Thank you.
And if you want to see or hear any of my interviews on Money Making Conversations, please go to moneymakingconversation.com. I am Rashawn McDonald. I am your host.